You create the fruit of the vine, and it's you who keeps us alive. You sustain us through every season. Holy, cleansed by your word, it's you who came among us to serve. Grant that we would serve one another. Oh, blessed are you, blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe. You will save us from evil. It would have been enough for from evil.
Let's give him a joy. Never changed. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. And Lord, we submit ourselves to you. You're our God. You're the creator of all things. And we today are so grateful that you sent Jesus. We're so excited in our spirits that this is the day that he rose again. Father, we praise you. Let today be remembered by you as the day that we honored and praised you and rejoiced before you for this wonderful thing. Very special for me personally because I commissioned that song 10 years ago. I rang our worship leader at the time and said, I want you to write me a song. Like King David asked his head worship guy to write some songs. And I said, I'd like you to write a song and I want the words, blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, about that prayer that's prayed at Passover and, you know, where we talk about the bread of the earth and the fruit of the vine. And this Tash was on that team at the time, and the team came up with that beautiful song. So thank you worship team. All right, well, that was a surprise. I had asked Tash some time ago, would it be possible ever to sing that song? And she did it today. Isn't it amazing? Hope you enjoyed that. It's always been a very anointed song. Thank you, guys. Are you strumming through the whole message? No? All right. No. Not today. One day. Well, good morning, everybody. He's alive. Jesus is alive. I'm so excited. In fact, I was up before dawn, which is actually my habit, but today particularly, I was replaying the day of the resurrection. And, you know, in the grey light of dawn, I remembered that Mary went to the tomb, and I thought, this is about the time she went. And just as the grey light's coming up, the birds, just little one by one, begin to sing, and I was thinking, yes, this was in a garden, it's the garden tomb, so there would have been birds and they would have started to sing. And I thought, isn't this wonderful? The birds would have been singing about this event. And then I relived the whole thing, but through each stage. And so today I would like to talk on the subject of the resurrection, on specifically this amazing festival that is an appointment of God. It is the third great appointment of God. The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. Have you got your Bibles here today? I hope so, on this particular day. Let's hold up our Bibles, shall we? Will you hold up your Bibles or electronic devices with your Bible on, just so no one's embarrassed? You can hold up your empty phone or the full phone, whatever you've got. Hold it up. Come on. Let's hold up something in our hands to say that we honor the Lord here today. Thank you, everybody. Now, you can read these scriptures with me as we go through. I'm sure that Vanessa or whoever's doing this, well, won't be Vanessa, she's on the camera, but it will be somebody putting these scriptures up or not. Why don't you find them in your scripture, your Bibles, and underline them? The book 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11 says, "For no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus the Messiah." There is no other foundation. We make a lot of the festivals here and the great appointments of God, and we're going to go through some of these in a little bit more detail. But can I just say that the festivals will never, ever overshadow what the festivals were purposed for, and that is the revealing of the Messiah, Jesus. So if we get excited about the festival but not the Messiah, then we're in trouble, because the festivals were there as a means to the end, and the end is Messiah Jesus himself. So let's together lay the foundation. Let's do it. If you're not used to being in a church where we just go into the scriptures, buckle up. Let's go into the festival, because when we open the scriptures, it forces us to realize that we are submitted to the Lord Almighty and that He has given commands. And therefore, if we're in submission to Him, then we have to obey them. It makes us realize that, and it tightens up our life, and we don't become slack, but become solid believers and followers of Jesus. Okay, the first day of the season, the first appointment was on Aviv 14. And we have celebrated that on Aviv 14, Passover, the first of God's great appointments with mankind. What happened? Jesus was crucified. Now, we say that the children of Israel came out of Egypt and delivered from slavery. That's a foresign of the Messiah. And the Messiah rose from the... Sorry, he died on that day. And on that day, back in Egypt, God delivered the children of Israel, and the final plague was the plague of the Passover. The firstborn of Egypt were going to die, or firstborn of anybody who didn't follow God's instructions were going to die if they didn't kill a lamb at twilight and put the blood on the doorposts and the lintels. At midnight, the angel of the Lord, the rabbis say it was God himself, passed through the land and killed the firstborn as the final plague, the tenth and final plague. But he passed over. The word literally is sprung over, leapt over, skipped over the houses where the blood was on the doorposts and the lintels. What does it speak of? It speaks of Jesus. It speaks of the Messiah. On Passover, the 14th day of Aviv, our Messiah died. And he was wrapped in white linen cloth, and he was anointed with oils and perfumes by two Pharisees who are members of the Sanhedrin, and they were believers that Jesus was the Messiah. We shouldn't be hard on the Pharisees. Many of the Pharisees believed in Jesus the Messiah and continued, of course, to be Pharisees. Very respected group of the population were the Pharisees. The names of these two were Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea, and they put Jesus' body into Joseph's own tomb. He was a rich man, but he dedicated his tomb. He gave it up for Jesus and put him in that tomb. The book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 1 says, "And I, brethren," the Apostle Paul speaking, "when I came to you, I did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus the Messiah and Him crucified. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and much trembling. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." Paul said that I preach Christ and I preach Him crucified. Yes. This is my message. He wasn't preaching about the resurrection. The resurrection is the sign of the power of Jesus' death. Yes. It's a sign, the exclamation of mark of God, that God has accepted Him. But it was Jesus' death on the cross that Paul preached, because not a man can be saved except they believe on the Messiah who died and shed His blood. It's a big subject, friends. We need to get our heads around it, but it is His death that matters. And why? Because God's justice system, whether we like it or whether we don't, is a measure for measure justice system. Eye for eye, tooth for tooth. You've heard it before. Life for life. Doesn't mean we go out and cut people's hands off and pluck people's eyes out. It means that there must be a balance if in the justice system of God. And in this case, all people deserve to die, because we've broken God's laws, we've broken His commandments, we've walked away from the kingdom of God, we haven't obeyed anything in the constitution of the kingdom, and so we're unrighteous. And the death of the wicked is the measure for measure response from God for that. But in the case of Messiah, when Jesus died, here's the thing. He was completely righteous. He kept the commands He had to keep in the Torah. He was sinless. He was innocent. And yet he died. And I think if the devil had known what would happen, the devil would never have let him die. He would never have convicted him. He would never have roused the people around him against him. He would never have put his demon spirits, to stir up such trouble. And in the Romans, every Easter, many, many times I watch the Passion at this time of year, just to remind myself that Jesus died, and it's his death, and it's his gory and gruesome death at the hands of sinful men that is the reason for our salvation. That's the thing. Thank you. You can clap. Who was clapping? Was that you, Coral? Let's give the Lord a hand. It's worth a clap. Thank you. Jesus' death was unjust. He was completely righteous. And therefore, when he died, the scales of God's justice system were out of balance. So the balance of the scales to be restored, Jesus' death therefore merits something. There's a merit there. It's hanging there. It's like the account book hasn't been reconciled. So how do we reconcile if God's Son has died unjustly? Therefore, to balance it, he invites that whosoever believes on him, whether you're wicked or whether you're not, and you're wicked, we're wicked, I'm wicked. That if you're wicked and you believe on him, this is the deal, then his merit that he has gained by dying as a righteous man can be attributed to you and me. And the scales balance up. This is God's justice system, if you want to know how it works. His righteousness and then his unjust death means that he can apply his merit to all who believe on him as Messiah. That's his deal that he made with the Lord. It was pre-decided before he came. My salvation, my future resurrection have been purchased by Jesus' righteous death. It's his death. That's why Paul says it is his death that I preach. I preach Christ and him crucified. That's my message. I have redeemed you. I have bought you back at great price, says the Lord. As a result, Jesus has the keys, therefore, to bring you back to life. He has what the scripture calls the keys of Hades, or the keys of Sheol. And it is so for all who believe on him as the Messiah, the Son of God. And the Apostle Paul says, 1 Corinthians 2:2, that's where this verse is coming from, I am determined not to know anything among you except Jesus the Messiah and him crucified. That's the basis of our salvation. And you can read about that, little ad, in the Passover to Pentecost magazine. And you'll find that on page 3. We've worked very hard to get this out so that you will be able to follow through. If you're watching online, little extra plug, you can download the Passover to Pentecost magazine in the description box that's appearing on your screen. And I trust our guys upstairs will be able to do that. No pressure. So Jesus' physical body was now, we're coming to the end of that first day of V14, the Passover, and his body now has been taken down from the cross, wrapped. It's been put inside the tomb. It's in the tomb on that first day, the 14th day of Aviv. And already his body may be there, but two angels have already come and taken him, his soul, to a place called paradise. Yes, Sheol, that's fine, but paradise. Meanwhile, on the same day, over on the Kidron Valley, who's been to Israel and you've gone down the Temple Mount and through the Kidron Valley and walked up the other side? Who's done that? Who's done that little walk? Down the bottom, there's a little brook. It's not there now, but there was a brook in the time called the Kidron Brook. And you'd go down and through and up on the other side. And just there, up on the Mount of Olives, there was a stand of barley. It's a very special stand of barley. It was not fertilized or watered by human hands. It was for God's special use. It was It was specifically for this day. And on that same day that Jesus was being tried and crucified, at some point while he was probably hanging on the cross with all that furor that was happening around Jerusalem at that time, three members of the Sanhedrin walked down and across the Kidron Valley, across the brook, and came up to the hill to that special stand of barley. They pulled out a cord and they put a cord around three sheaves or several sheaves that summed up to three shears. That's a measurement. And they were called the first fruits. So this was on the day of Passover. They did so. They couldn't do this the next day because it was a Shabbat, a high Sabbath. And then the men left and they got themselves ready for the Shabbat that evening that was approaching. On that same day as Jesus was dying, Passover lambs were being killed by the thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands. Go and watch the Torah portion from yesterday. Pastor Kyle described the handing of the blood through little cones, right hands, through a line of priests, all the way down the line, empty cones coming back the same line. Absolutely astounding how they processed so many tens and tens and tens of thousands of sheep that day. But whilst they were all being offered, the people were preparing for the Passover Seder and eating of unleavened bread. We move to the second day, Aviv 15. Are you all okay? You're very sort of very, it's wonderful and quiet. You okay following along so far? On Aviv 15, the first day of the 7-day festival of unleavened bread, this festival that we're in right now lasts for 7 days, God's second great appointment with mankind. And you can read about that on page 46 of your Passover to Pentecost booklet. As the sun set on that day, the Aviv the 14th, Seder candles were being lit on beautifully decorated tables. The lambs were prepared. The leaven was out of everyone's home. The matzah, the unleavened bread, had been made. The father or the head of the household was now opening with prayer. And the children were very, very excited. I don't know about you, but our children in our Seder were very, very excited. And the head of the household had his latest copy of the Passover to Pentecost magazine with all the testimonies and excellent articles about the Torah portion and everything on there and the upcoming guest speakers. But most importantly, the Seder order, the order of the Seder. There was laughter, there was prayer as this came about as the evening rolled across and they started their setters. There was singing as the story of the first Passover began to be told about the time in Egypt, God sparing the firstborn, etc. If they believed in putting the blood on the doorposts and lintels, they'd be spared. If they didn't, they wouldn't. And it reminds me of when Paul and Silas were in Philippi and they were in prison and it was nearing midnight and they were singing psalms and God sent an earthquake and the doors opened up and all the prisoners could get out and the jailer was going to kill himself. But Paul and Silas came to him. Acts chapter 16, verse 29, the jailer called for a light. He ran in, fell down trembling before Paul and Silas, and he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Don't you wish that every time you went out to the shop, someone would come up to you and say, "Excuse me, what must I do to be saved?" Wouldn't that make the job so easy? So Paul and Silas said, listen to this very carefully. Tell me what they're thinking of. Believe on the Lord Jesus, the Messiah, and you will be saved, you and your whole household. Where have we seen this before? We saw it in Exodus. The blood went on the doorposts and the lintels. Everyone in that house was spared. The whole household was saved by the blood of the Lamb. Can you see Paul's mentality here? Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and all who were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night, washed their stripes. This is the jailer. He washed them because they'd been whipped. And immediately he and all of his family were immersed. They were baptized. And when he brought them into his house, he set food before them. And he rejoiced, having believed in God with all of his household. That is the power of the Seder. That's the power of the Passover. Pastor Kyle mentioned it. I'm not dwelling on it. But he said, do this in remember of me. We've swapped it out with communion because we had to. Because if you don't celebrate the Passover, you've got to have something that Jesus was referring to. But if you take it back to what he's saying, do this every year in remembrance of me. You'll be saved, you and your household, because they'll hear this story year by year and they'll be saved. They'll come to believe. And so while the setters were in full swing, Jesus' body was laid wrapped in linen. But as I said, only his body was there because his soul wasn't there. And Jesus was actually being very busy somewhere else. His soul was where? In paradise. Paradise or paradisu means orchard. It means garden. Two very privileged angels had taken him there. He was in paradise, orchard or garden, which is another way of saying Gan Eden, which means Garden of Eden. And he was not in heaven at this stage, and we know that from things that he said later, but he was in paradise. He had certainly been truthful to the thief that was hanging beside him on the cross in Luke 23:43 when he said, assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Not in heaven, in paradise. That's where Jesus was. Paradise, which is located, as someone said, in the place where souls go when they've departed. The scripture calls that Sheol, and this is not a big subject about this, but it stands between corruptibility and incorruptibility and the place where souls go when they die, and this is where Jesus was. Paul explains this in Ephesians 4, chapter 9, when he says, now this, and he's talking about a scripture from the Psalms, he ascended, what does it mean? But that he also first descended into the lower parts of the earth. He who descended is also the one who ascended far above all the heavens that he might fill all things. By the time he wrote this, Jesus had ascended to heaven. But at the time of the Passover, Jesus hadn't. He'd gone to a place called paradise, descended to there. From his place in paradise, he declared across the abyss. We see this in Luke 16, this where he starts to speak across this place called the abyss, which is where the fallen angels, Peter tells us, are. Those that sinned during the first part of Earth's history and cohabited with the children of men, the women, and created the giants of that time, that's where they are, imprisoned, according to the scripture, and certainly all the rabbinical writings support that. And he preached to them across this abyss of his unjust death, but God's justice and his power would raise him from the dead. So his body's in the tomb, still and lifeless, but his soul is hard at work. 1 Peter 3:18 says, for Messiah also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but being made alive in the spirit, by whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison, who formerly were disobedient when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is only 8 souls, were saved through water. That's what Jesus was doing down in paradise, speaking across. The setters were finally finished. The aphicomen had been found. Now we're sort of back in real world. Everyone's finished their setters. The children hadn't killed each other trying to find the aphicomen, which nearly happened in our setter. It was like Kyle said, this is where gridiron was invented, where the person with the aphicomen is supposed to be quite safe, but not in this household. The other kids tried to tackle him and get it out of his hands. But anyway, the story has been told. Who did a setter? Who attended a setter? It's amazing, isn't it? The big meal, as Tash said, has been eaten. We're so full. And people said goodbye and went home. This is the still all on the V15. What a special day. The next morning was still a V15 because the days go from sunset to sunset. And people spent the day reliving the night before, resting and spending time with their families and eating the leftovers from yesterday. Yeah. No work was done because it was a high Sabbath. The streets were bare. No shops were open. And afternoon naps were sort of like mandatory for anyone who has children, you know, and also grandpas, by the way. Then the sunset came upon the first day of unleavened bread, the Aviv, the 15th, and that day came to an end. So now we're at the end of the second day. The third day, what day do you think this is? Aviv what? 16. It's excellent. I'm glad you're following along. Aviv 16. Jesus had died on Aviv 14th, just reminding you. He was in the tomb and in paradise on Aviv 15. On the third day, Aviv 16 was the day that he rose. That's today, by the way. That's today. We're on Aviv 16. Mark 9:31. For he taught his disciples and said to them, "The Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And after he is killed, he will rise on the third day." He died on the first day, he was in the tomb on the second day, and he rose on the third day. This is God's third great appointment with mankind. Can you see that every appointment has something to do with Jesus, the Messiah?
Yeah.
These that were commanded right deep in the heart of the Torah are being fulfilled by our Messiah? Now, it's about this time that three stars came. Sunset's about to happen, or just happened. Three stars became visible in the sky, indicating that it was now twilight. That's how you know twilight. Three stars have appeared. Therefore, the sun had set, and the full moon has just started to rise in the east. Dean and I did this experiment years ago with a drone. We went up because a full moon happens when the sun is setting and the moon is rising. That's the perfect full moon. Dean, it was a cloudy night, unfortunately, but anyway, we had fun doing this. So the full moon's rising in the east, and those same three members of the Sanhedrin were going back across the Kidron Valley. Crowds of excited Jewish people from the neighborhoods were gathering to watch, and these three men went up, and remember, they had put a cord around the three sheaves here. And so they went up with their sickles and they started this ceremony. You'll find this in the rabbinical writings. It's absolutely amazing. They addressed the crowd and said, "Has the sun set?" And all the people shouted back, with the kids the loudest, "Yes." The three men responded, "Shall we cut with the sickle?" It sounds like a children's church message. "Shall we cut with the sickle?" And the crowd responded, "Yes." And they said again, "Shall we cut with the sickle?" "Yes." For the last time, "Shall we cut with the sickle?" "Yes." You know, pulling their hair out, "Cut the blooming sheaves of barley." Then three times the three men asked, "Shall we place the grain in the basket?" So they cut the barley. "Shall we place it in the basket?" Three times they asked this, and the people three times said, "Yes, you know, do it." And finally, three times, you know, oh, here we go. Shall I begin to cut it now? "Yes." "Shall I put it in the basket?" And so this little harvest began, and the men collected three seahs of barley in their baskets and carried it back across the Kidron Valley the same night, more than enough grain to make into the required omer of fine flour. That's the weight. That's what's commanded in the book of Leviticus. Leviticus 23:9, "And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, 'Speak to the children of Israel and say to them, when you come into the land which I give you and reap its harvest, then you shall bring an omer of the first fruits of your harvest to the priest.' It was prohibited to use or eat from this year's new crop across the land. No one could touch their barley until this had happened. And it happened on this day. You couldn't eat of your grapes. You couldn't eat of your wheat when it ripened. You couldn't do anything unless this was accepted by God. This was the first fruits of the year. This is the first month of the year. It was a reminder and a memorial that the land and its produce belongs to who? The Lord. The earth is the Lord's and all its fullness." So they had to do this. "And until the people have harvested and offered the first fruits of the barley, in the temple, the rest of the crops were not considered kosher. Even if you ate kosher grain, it was not kosher as long as this had not been done. We're going to see how this relates to the Messiah, and I'm reminded of a parable he spoke where a man was found at the wedding feast in the wrong clothes. The man said, and the owner said, "How did you get in here?" And he said, out. You've got to do it in the prescribed way. Once the three men returned with their basket of barley to the temple, remember it's now nighttime, the full moon's out, the priests themselves took it and processed it. They threshed it, they roasted it, and finally they ground that barley into flour. And this they did by milling it, grinding it, sifting, grinding, sifting, regrinding, sifting, grinding, sifting. 13 times they did this throughout the night. And the rabbis say this took much of the night. So throughout the night, this is happening. Meanwhile, back in paradise, a miracle was happening. They're grinding the omer ready to present it. Something else is happening in paradise. And this was the miracle that's going to affect the entire world. In paradise, in the Garden of Eden, there's a stirring. Crowds of souls of the righteous, because that's who's in paradise, were gathering to see what all the commotion was about. The news was that someone, the Messiah, had come to paradise who had died unjustly. The word was out that decisions were being made in the upper heavens right now about whether death could legally keep him locked up and behind the gates of Hades or Sheol. Then came the word and the excitement rose to fever pitch as the crowd heard the news. Jesus was walking by and with him was a small group of people or souls. And he came with these patriarchs, and in that group was Noah and Abraham and Sarah and Isaac and Rebecca and Jacob and Rachel and Leah and Moses and Deborah and King David and the prophet Jeremiah and many others that I won't mention now, I'll be here for a while. But most notably, the person who had been there the longest of all, Abel. You all said Adam. Abel. And beside him was his mother and his father, Adam and Eve. As well, there was one special person in this group who sort of didn't belong, but he did. And he was the one who'd been there the shortest time. Who do you think that was? The thief on the cross. Jesus actually invited him to be a part of this. Today you will be with me in paradise. This group moved amongst the cheering crowds of paradise towards the gates of Hades, of Sheol. And they could all see that he had two keys in his hand. As he came to the great gate that seems impenetrable, he turned back towards the crowd and he held up the two keys and they shouted and roared. He hushed them down, sort of like American Congress, you know. Revelation 1:18, I am he who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death. His words were drowned out by the cheers as he turned back to place the keys in the gate. But the spirit of death, like a looming cloud, came and challenged him and said in the hearing of all, it's decreed by God from the days of Adam that none can depart from here. Of course, he was referring to Genesis 2 and 16. You can follow this along in your Bible. It's probably, is it appearing behind me? No, not nothing. No, no scripture appeared so far? Oh, excellent, excellent. That's great. So read it in your scriptures. Genesis 2:16. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat of it you shall surely die. And death quoted the scripture, because he quotes scriptures. No one leaves here, according to the Lord. Both Adam and Eve, who were standing next to Jesus, felt a pang of shame. But Jesus grabbed them by the hand and encouraged them, assuring them that everything would soon be resolved. Death's argument was short-lived, because at that moment the Holy Spirit came upon Jesus, resplendent, glorious, and enveloped him. And though death continued sort of weakly to continue to argue his case, he was for the very first time forced to permanently stand aside, unable to grasp the Messiah Jesus to hold him. As the scripture says in Acts chapter 2 verse 24, Jesus of Nazareth, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be held by it. Death had no grip on him. He had nothing to hang on to. Death could not resist, because the decision had been made that Jesus was unjustly here and the power of God was simply too great for him. Death knew he had no dominion upon the Messiah and could not hold him. The scripture goes on to say in Romans chapter 6 verse 8, now if we die with Messiah, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Messiah, having been raised from the dead, dies no more. That's what resurrection is. Raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him, says Paul. He says in verse 11 of chapter 8 of Romans, but if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Messiah from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. The Messiah slotted the keys into the gates of Sheol and turned them. And as he opened the great gates, he passed through, he looked back, and he saw death hurriedly closing the gates again, trying to secure it, but not before a few others had slipped out as well. But he got it closed before the majority. Jesus, clothed in the glory of the Spirit, stopped and said to everyone who remained inside, your time is coming soon. He encouraged them. At the end of the age, when I will come and open these gates forever. And then he was gone. The same two angels, dressed in long white robes, transported the Messiah Jesus, his soul, through the dimensions and back to inside the tomb. The Shekinah, the Holy Spirit, was with them as they re-entered the earthly realm with Jesus' soul, and the earth began to tremble. This is what happens when God's presence touches earth. It happened on Mount Sinai. It happened on the cross. It happened here. And the Spirit of God shook the earth. Just his presence does that. Not the presence of the angels, but the presence of the Holy Spirit, the presence of God. Inside the tomb, the angels carefully reintroduced Jesus' soul into his body, and the Holy Spirit again breathed life, and the Messiah's physical body came to life within the linen wrapping, and his body began to twitch and move. Remember this point. One angel removed the linen cloth for him while the other rolled back the heavy stone which closed the tomb. The Roman guards, who were outside but were fully awake because they'd just had an earthquake, suddenly saw the stone rolling back. Okay, this is going to freak anyone out. The angel stepped out, his face shining like brilliant lightning and his clothes like the brightest snow. Then the angel, he must have been an Aussie angel, because he then hopped up on the stone he just rolled and had a seat. Like that was a hard job or something. And the hardened Roman guards, in complete shock and fear, just fainted. They fainted. That was it. They went comatose. As Jesus stepped free of his linen cloth, he then himself unwound his head cloth, his own head cloth. He unwound it and he neatly folded it and placed it separate to the other cloths. The angel that was still inside who had helped him out of the cross watched Jesus do this and thought to himself, that's sure to start an urban myth. But he didn't say it because, let's face it, this was the king. Jesus stepped now out of the open tomb. It was still nighttime. We don't know exactly what time it was, but it was certainly between sunset and dawn. So it's nighttime. The moon was out. After Jesus was resurrected, those other souls that had slipped out through the gates, when he came out, they began to revive from the dead and begin to walk down into Jerusalem. The scripture says, Mark 27:52, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. That's what the Gospels say. These ones were not resurrected because they would go on to die. In fact, death did a count and found out there were some missing, and he ended up tracking them down. Once the furor in paradise, he'd settled everyone back down again and it subsided. He took them back to Sheol at some point in the end of their lives. Now the dawn approached. Here's where we get to the crux of this. The Marys and Joanna and other women disciples of Jesus were making their way to the tomb just before dawn, thinking that they would freshen the spices of Jesus' wrapped corpse. They weren't able to do it previously because the Shabbat had come. And they were wondering out loud who would roll back the stone for them. Instead of finding a closed tomb, they found no guards. They had taken off by now. And an open tomb with the two glorious shining angels standing there expecting their arrival. The book of Luke says in chapter 24, verse 5, then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, the angel said to the women, why do you seek the living amongst the dead? He's not here, but he's risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and crucified, and the third day rise again. They remembered now. The two angels then became the very first tour guides to the garden tomb, and they set a precedent for all future guides for the tomb. You know, even our Fraser Harding, and probably watching online, Fraser, unless you're here in the congregation, who was a tour guide for the garden tomb, the angels began to show the women around the tomb. And it says there in Matthew 28:6, he's not here, he is risen. And he said, come and see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and indeed he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring the disciples the word. So the women went. They got the disciples. Peter and John ran back to the tomb. They came inside the tomb. They saw the linen cloths. They were surprised to see the folded handkerchief. Peter held it up amazed. Look at this, he said to John. John thought to himself, note to self, that might start an urban myth. I'd better mention that when I write my gospel. The Shroud of Turin I'm sort of talking about here, if people haven't picked it up. You know, the whole, anyway. You picked it up the first time I said it, didn't you? The disciples walked away bewildered, but Mary remained at the open tomb, so puzzled. And then comes one of the most remarkable things. But meanwhile, back at the temple, early in the morning, before dawn, the high priest, Caiaphas, took the finely ground flour that the priest had been working on all night, 13 times, mixed the special barley flour with oil to prepare it as a grain offering. As he was preparing the dough, he was thinking to himself about the strange things that had happened over the previous couple of days. What stuck most in his mind was not that he'd caused the death of Jesus, the troublemaker, but that as Jesus had died, the veil in the temple had split in two. This was still puzzling him greatly because it was an impossible thing. John 20, verse 11 to 17. Let's turn this to this scripture here. Let's read this scripture together. John 20:11. But Mary stood outside the tomb weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. Then they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "Because they've taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they've laid him." Now when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, and did not know that it was Jesus. Verse 15, Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" The last she'd seen of Jesus was he was dead on the cross with body hair ripped out, a mess. She supposed to be him to be the gardener and said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned to him and said, "Rabboni," which is to say teacher or my teacher. Jesus said to her, "Don't cling to me. Don't touch me. Don't cling to me. I have not yet ascended to my Father." I haven't been to heaven yet. Where had he been? Paradise. Sheol. Caiaphas took the dough in his hands and in the sight of all the other priests waved it before the Lord with the appropriate frankincense, which is the prescribed way of doing it. Leviticus 23:11, "He shall wave the sheaf before the Lord to be accepted on your behalf. On the day after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it." The 16th day of Aviv, he shall wave it back and forth, up and down. And it is to keep away the evil dews and evil winds and to bring the blessing of God upon the crops of the land. And he touched the dough to the corner of the altar of the sacrifice. And then he baked the dough into bread. After the dawn morning burnt offering and additional Passover sacrifices that took place then at dawn. So dawn's broken. Mary's at the tomb. The priests are there offering up the omer of barley, which has now been made into dough and has now been baked into bread. The first burnt offering of the day is taking place, plus additional Passover sacrifices that are taking place. And when that's finished, it's concluded with the ceremony of a very special final offering, a single male lamb as a burnt offering to the Lord, only to be done on this day, Aviv 16, and to accompany the waving of the omer. Leviticus 23:12, "And you shall offer on that day, when you wave the sheaf, a male lamb of the first year without blemish as a burnt offering to the Lord." He accompanied the burnt offering by also offering the omer bread upon the altar. Once it was offered, as I've said, the first fruit of the nation's barley crop, in fact, all crops, could be eaten because God had now blessed the land and blessed the crops. You can now partake of your barley and your crops, the fruit, because the first fruit has been accepted by God. So this was a moment of great rejoicing indeed, and it was most likely at this very same time that Jesus ascended to heaven to be presented before God the Father as the first fruit offering for all mankind, the first human that has ever been resurrected, the only human that has been resurrected so far. Remember, resurrection is defined by those who are come to life but do not die again. Others are just being revived for a time and then death gets them again. Apart from Elijah and Enoch, I know you're thinking that in your head. Talk to me about that later. But anyway, by the end of the day, Jesus' death had been accepted by God, just like the omer of barley had been accepted. And now the nation of Israel could partake of Messiah's death and resurrection. We'll read it in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, a beautiful chapter of our Bibles, verse 20. "But now Messiah is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep," those who have died. "For since by man came death," Adam, "by man," Jesus, "also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Messiah all shall be made alive, but each one in his own order, Messiah the first fruits. Afterward, those who are Messiahs at his coming." 1 Corinthians 15, Verse 23, read it. So on that day, God's third appointment with mankind, the feast of first fruits, the presenting of the omer of the barley, the day our Messiah rose from the dead, the day we begin the countdown to Pentecost, a command from God to count the 7 weeks, the 50 days, right through to the fourth great appointment with mankind, which is Shavuot, Pentecost, the day the Holy Spirit shows up in power and great demonstration and fills those who have believed on Him with power to go and declare the gospel of Jesus to the whole world. And you'll find that on page 64 of the Passover to Pentecost booklet, and Pastor Cole will probably speak to you about that. Let me finish off now. One day when He returns, if you believe, you will be raised from the dead at His coming. Messiah Jesus will walk up to the gates of Sheol, to Hades, and He will fling them open. Death will not be able to keep those doors shut anymore. Death's time of usefulness is nearly up. But those righteous who believe on Jesus will be accompanied by angels back to their bodies. There will be a great earthquake, as the scripture says. The Mount of Olives will split in two. The dead will be raised back into their physical bodies, incorruptible, and they shall be that way forever with Jesus. And those of us who are still alive when He returns will have our bodies quickened, made alive, recreated imperishable and incorruptible, also in resurrected bodies, unable to die again, as the scripture says, Romans 8:11. But if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, that He who raised Messiah from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. In 1 Corinthians 6:14, my final scripture, and God both raised up the Lord and will also raise us up by His power. Hallelujah. Let's give Him a hand. We praise You, Jesus. We praise You, Lord. We praise You, Lord. Now, dear friends, I want this to be a message to us here right now. There are some in this place that have not committed their life to Jesus. You have not believed in Him. Therefore, there is no future that I have just described, because the basis of His death and the basis of His resurrection having any power in our lives has to do with us believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, and then we shall be saved. Yes. If you have never believed on the Lord Jesus, if you've never given Him your life and submitted to Him, then today is your day, and I want to give you that opportunity now. Jesus said, if you will come before God, before people, I will represent you before God. Hallelujah. We do it publicly in this place because people have to acknowledge before men that Jesus is the Messiah. If that's you today and your heart's been touched, we're all going to stand. I'm going to have the worship team just come and play just briefly. And just everybody stand. Worship team come. Everybody stand.